Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Twisted Potions by Al K. Line. Narrated by Emma Powell. A Strange Dinner. I puffed out my chest, told myself for the 100th time everything would be fine and this was just me cooking dinner to repay a debt, and forced my heart to slow. Acting without permission, my fist bunched until the knuckles were bone white and rapped on the sturdy but discoloured door. After an interminable wait and the sound of numerous locks and bolts being fiddled with, as only the truly paranoid or those with something to hide ever employ, the door opened a fraction. A wary, weeping eye belonging to a face deep in shadow peered through the crack. My host looked around furtively. Then he focused on me and opened the door wide in what I could only assume was pleasure. The stench of stale body odour, unwashed laundry, and unmentionable excretions assaulted my nostrils. But that wasn't what sent me reeling back a few steps, forcing me to grab the railing lest I collapse. It was the deep, pungent, potent chemical cocktail of fire, brimstone, acid, steam, and all manner of deadly potions bubbling away in his lab come home, freezing my nervous system and dissolving half my lungs that almost did for me.
"Kate, you came!"
exclaimed the chemist in utter delight as he reached out a long, misshapen arm, grabbed me by my lapel, and pulled me in before checking outside again. He slammed the door behind us, fumbled with the locks and bolts until he was satisfied, then rested his back against the scarred panelling and smiled. I wondered how long I had to live, and if I had time to call my husband and tell him I loved him. It was doubtful. My lungs were on fire, cells dying by the million, and I found it hard to form a coherent thought. I couldn't imagine a time when I could use full sentences in such a torturous atmosphere. Rooted to the spot, I didn't resist as the chemist said,
"Here, let me take that,"
and proceeded to slide my long leather jacket off one arm. It got stuck as he tried to remove it from the other, as I hadn't let go of the bag containing everything I needed to make a nice dinner. I came to my senses and managed to loosen my grip. The bag dropped to the floor, getting tangled up in my jacket, so thankfully nothing broke.
"Don't worry," he said nervously. "You'll get used to it. Best thing to do is breathe deep, get it over with, and in a few minutes you won't even notice the smell."
He gave me a joyful smile, or attempted to, but only part of his face worked. Half his face was without functioning nerves. Most of his features melted down so one side hung like a mannequin's after a fire. There was a gaping hole in his cheek so you could see his decaying teeth and white-coated tongue, and one eye wept continually, red raw and oozing. His head was a mess of scar tissue and crisscrossed with thick red and white welts in the throes of a serious party. Wispy grey hairs hung long and lank, but through it all, it was clear he was happy to see me, was feeling somewhat nervous himself, and wasn't quite sure how to act. Guess he didn't get many female visitors. Guess he didn't get many visitors of any description.
"I cleaned up,"
he said brightly, reaching down for the bag without having to actually bend. His arms were so long. "Uh-huh," I managed to grunt, taking in the room without risking moving my head or breathing just yet. I'd heard all about this place, but hadn't believed it. Now I was thinking I hadn't been told the true extent of how bad it was. Still, he seemed content. I guess ghouls obsessed with all things alchemical have a warped sense of what cleanliness is. Running down the centre of the single large room was an ancient, scarred, burned, chunky wooden workbench, covered with jars of powders and liquids, and various notebooks. Some stacked precariously, others open and full of spidery writing and strange, worrying diagrams. Bunsen burners hissed, burning blue or startling orange. Strange tubes slithered from one bulbous, bubbling jar to another, all colours of the rainbow spitting and hissing as the contents simmered behind murky glass. The threadbare carpet was mostly hidden by books, mounds of dirty dishes and takeaway remains, piles of festering shirts and underwear. In one corner was a bare mattress, so stained and sallow it didn't look suitable for burning, let alone sleeping on. The kitchen area consisted of a cramped alcove. There was a sink with a dripping tap, a small section of counter free of chemicals, and an oven that was so old it was probably an antique. I was sweating badly now, the humidity so high I was amazed the chemist could get anything to burn. And overriding everything else was the caustic, sulphurous stink that made breathing seem like a fast track to the afterlife. My ears began to sting, and I realized that everything was silent, the only noise the bubbling of the jars. This was getting awkward. Not wanting to offend, I shunted magic through my still fresh full-body tattoos, let my inherited hidden magic combine with my vampire nature, and my body purged itself of several cancer-inducing, tumour-causing, death-giving compounds already circulating through my system. I pulled back my shoulders, sucked in air cautiously through my nostrils, thinking maybe it would filter it a little, exhaled, smiled wide with my new red lipstick now seeming like a bad idea as it was steaming off my lips, and said, "So nice of you to invite me. What a lovely home you have." The chemist grinned and did a little jig on the spot like an excited child, gave a fancy bow, then nervously stepped aside to reveal his surprise.
"Thought we should do it in style."
"Oh, that's, very thoughtful," I said, nodding at him, then studying the small square table he'd covered with what looked like a dirty white sheet. In the centre was a large bell jar with a stub of candle, the flame stuttering under the strange mix of gases in the room, oxygen way down on the list. "Very intimate."
"Thank you for this. I don't get many guests."
The chemist dumped my bag by the sink, then lumbered to his workbench and turned a knob to reduce the heat under a bottle of something green and probably dangerous, close to bubbling over. "My pleasure. I promised I'd cook for you when you got us out of that scrape, so here I am." I picked my jacket up from the floor, decided it would be rude to throw it outside, so draped it over the back of a chair instead.
"Great.
Great." There was another awkward silence, and it was getting ridiculous. He was a nice guy, a nice ghoul, and just because he was trapped in the mortal world and ate decomposing flesh now and then when he could resist the urge no longer, didn't make him a bad person. "Okay, let's cook," I said, smiling and reaching out for his hand.
"You want me to help?"
he asked with surprise. "Sure, it'll be fun." I took his ruined hand, all lumps and hard calluses, fingers half fused and nails yellow and broken, and we squeezed. Then we set about making dinner. "Hi, I'm Kate Pound, reluctant vampire enforcer, and I'm on a date. It's okay. My husband knows." Smokin. I cooked steak and potatoes with butter-drenched green beans from our garden on the side. Nothing fancy, just basics done with care and attention. The chemist seemed to enjoy it immensely, and it was a pleasant dinner with some nice conversation, even though I took a while to adjust to how he'd devoured the meat with his hands. I'd prepared it just the way he liked it, meaning it almost touched the frying pan but was so rare it may as well have still been running about going moo. We chatted, we laughed, and I even mostly forgot about the smell. The chemist seemed delighted to have a proper conversation with someone, and he shared several stories about his past, about the years he felt so alone when he found himself a true supernatural creature, one of the hidden, stuck here with no way to return. He didn't go into the details, but he was here, and here he would stay. He liked it, loved what he did, and even though it tortured him to perform his comedy, it was in his blood and who he was. To my surprise, he turned out to be a genuinely nice guy, smart too. He just had to get past the utter strangeness of his mannerisms and the penchant for peeling bits of decaying or loose skin off his own body and surreptitiously popping the scabs into his mouth when he thought you weren't looking. When we'd finished, we leaned back in our chairs, both creaking dangerously, and groaned with post-meal happiness.
"Thank you, Kate. That was lovely."
"My pleasure. I said I'd make you dinner, and I keep my word. I owed you for helping us escape from that bit of bother."
"And did everything get resolved?"
he asked as he licked his plate, then poked a fork through his cheek and dislodged a few strips of meat. "Yep, all dealt with. It was my first job, but it went fine, even with everything else that was happening."
"Good, that's good. And I hear you're still working for Dancer?"
"For my sins." Dancer is head of the UK Hidden Council, in charge of all human and not-so-human magical affairs. And although by rights he's my boss, the reality is that Oscari, Vampire Head, has the final say.
"Here, let me..."
The chemist rose and moved to grab my empty plate. "No, you stay put. I'll clean up."
"Thank you. Oh, what a pleasant evening. I could get used to this."
The chemist laced his fingers behind his head and sighed with contentment. "You should try to find yourself a nice ghoul lady. It would give you some company. Maybe think about tidying up a bit. You could make this place nice." I took the dishes over to the alcove and wondered how I could clean them in such a fetid sink.
What do you mean? By ghoul standards, this is bordering on clinical. Many ghouls worth their salt would be proud to call this place home."
"Oh, well, there you go then," I said brightly. "You should start looking for someone. It's not good to be alone so much."
Maybe. But I have my work and it takes up a lot of time. Plus, I have plans."
I turned and stared at him. He was already at the bench, messing with his potions. It was serious, but it takes all sorts, I guess. For 5 minutes, we didn't speak as I drowned the dishes in washing up liquid and scoured the sink while they soaked. I scrubbed the draining board and tried, futilely, to disinfect the countertop. I wiped my hands dry on my white T-shirt, the only thing clean in the whole room, then went to see what he was up to. Mesmerised, I watched as he carefully broke seals on tiny brown vials arranged obsessively in a small wooden tray, each with a neatly printed label stuck on perfectly straight. He used a spoon so small it looked like something stolen from a fairy to sprinkle minute grains from each into a large beaker that changed colour and hissed and steamed with each addition. All the while, he poked his never-still tongue through the hole in his cheek in concentration. His hands were as steady as time itself. For a man who had more nervous tics than a vampire on a detox in a room full of naked virgins high on crack, it was a wondrous and strange sight to behold. Once satisfied, he settled the beaker on a metal tripod over a low heat and stood back, smiling.
"Now, we wait," he whispered.
"For what?"
"For it to work its magic. This is a powerful potion, but it takes weeks to make. It's worth it, though,"
he said, winking. Or maybe it was just a tick. "What does it do?"
"It makes you happy,"
he waggled his one eyebrow suggestively.
"Oh."
The chemist frowned, clearly expecting more animated response.
"No, I mean, really happy."
Okay. "What about this?" I asked, brushing my forearm against a large bulbous jar full of pink liquid, as I pointed at a tiny test tube held in a clamp above a flame so gentle it was almost a whisper. The chemist's eyes opened wide. His hair stood on end. and he panicked so much he tried to move in all directions at once. I watched as the peculiar jar I'd touched with my bare skin bubbled violently and turned dark and angry.
"You touched the glass!"
he screeched. "Sorry, but that's all right, isn't it?"
"No, the magic will react. Your hidden magic. Your vampire blood magic. It will seep through the glass. That can't happen.
He scrambled for a large beaker of cloudy liquid at the far end of the bench, but in his haste he knocked over countless empty vials, and as I moved to try to help him, I got a cut at my pinky. The chemist turned fast, as if he sensed the blood, and as I lifted my finger to suck it, he screamed, "No!" But it was too late. The blood on my finger beaded, fat and delicious, but then I felt an enormous pressure, as if the digit had been placed in a vacuum, and a sliver of blood was sucked from my finger right into what looked suspiciously like a gaping maw on the large jar I touched. The now murky liquid went nuts. It frothed until it spilled over the glass, doused the flame beneath, and chewed through the stand it was on. Finally, the whole lot sloshed over the bench and covered the neatly labelled vials. The bench dissolved, eaten away like by acid. Powders flashed and burned upon contact, releasing noxious fumes. More glass vials, tubes, powders and strange things in boxes were all drenched, and the bench was gone. Nothing left but a mound of bubbling pink froth expanding at an alarming rate. Blood was pouring from my hand now, not one finger, but all of them, and I felt woozy and sick. The chemist stared at the mess, then me, in a stupor, as my vision turned red. Blood was being sucked from my eyes. My nose was bleeding so bad I was getting a mouthful of the good stuff. Both my hands were sending streamers of potent claret into the frothing mess on the fast dissolving floor, and my head was swimming with myriad emotions, the half-finished potions affecting me in ways too scary to think about, even as my body worked overtime to eradicate the effects.
"Run!"
shouted the chemist as he headed for the door. Kind of pointless, as it took a while to get the numerous locks off. He still flung the door open dramatically, though, then ran. Vision almost gone, head ready to split open. A peculiar, emotionless state took me over. I walked in a calm manner while magic swirled and my tattoos grew fat and dangerous as timeless energy eddied around my system. Then my focus returned and I grabbed my jacket before dashing through the door and up the steps from the basement onto the road where the chemist was standing in a panic, brushing nervously at his head and checking the street. "What happened?" I asked, the calm evaporating, a deep dread having taken over.
"You just fed it. Now we're in trouble."
"Fed it? Fed what?"
"You'll see."
And with that, the chemist's home exploded. A cloud of pink gas burst through the door and expanded until the night was nothing but a pink haze.
"I think maybe we should have talked about the house rules before dinner," said the chemist.
"I think you might be right. Remind me never to go on a date with a ghoul again." Pink and Fluffy.
"I told you not to touch it,"
wailed the chemist, clawing at his bad eye, not that he had a good one, and rubbing his face so hard the already ruined flesh moulded into new shapes like Play-Doh. "No, you didn't. You didn't say anything about touching the outside of bloody bottles."
"Jars, they're jars. Don't you know anything about chemistry?"
I turned to him, astonished. "No, absolutely nothing. Why should I?"
"What?"
he spluttered, hands twitching, face little but one big tick now. His whole body was vibrating, feet tapping, arms convulsing.
"How can you not know anything about it? It's the most magical thing in the world."
"Apart from actual magic," I offered.
"This is bad. Oh, so bad,"
he wailed, close to losing the plot entirely. I tried to see what the result of the explosion was, but the air was thick with supernatural fog. Dense pink gas swirled up higher and higher into the clear sky, eddying and rippling, trails like tattered wings stretching away into the distance. I couldn't smell smoke, so assumed there was no raging inferno, but the strange pink gas was overpowering everything else. A peculiar mix of cloying, sweet smells and something akin to bitter almonds that was so thick my nose was becoming clogged. My compromised vision worsened as large particles stuck to my eyeballs until it was like looking through a thin layer of grit. At least the potion had stopped sucking the blood out of me, so there was that. The wind rose, blowing my dust-covered hair into my mouth. I brushed it aside, the taste acrid, burning my lips. "Okay, look," I said, trying to calm the situation down. "You've had explosions before, right?"
"Loads,"
he said proudly. "And you've dealt with the dwarves after you did a very stupid thing and tried to master transubstantiation, correct?" The chemist nodded.
"They weren't happy about that at all,"
he chuckled. "I bet. You can't go turning base metal into gold. What were you thinking?"
"It's the holy grail of alchemy. Who wouldn't want to do it?"
"Okay, so the smoke will clear, we'll go tidy up, and you can buy new ingredients. No problem." The chemist turned to face me full on and stared at me like I was an utter fool.
"Kate, you don't understand. You don't understand at all. That wasn't a petty potion to remove your scent or something to make you invisible for a few minutes. It wasn't just something to help you visit other realms or make you prettier. Not that you'd need that, of course," he added hurriedly. "That was the pinnacle of my career, much more potent than anything I've ever attempted. You saw what it did, how it took your blood, how it changed and grew, felt your presence through the glass and devoured some of your essence?"
"Yeah, so it's something odd, but you can handle it, right? Look, it's already dissipating." Although the gas had thinned around the now smashed door to his house, I'd failed to realise how thick it was around us, how it had seemingly gathered in the road where we stood right in the way of any traffic. Tyres screeched, headlights appeared from out of the gloom, and next thing I knew I was sailing through the air backwards, staring into the eyes of a shocked woman with pretty blonde hair moments after she hit me. This was really going to hurt. Mysterious strangers. My body slammed down onto the asphalt, and my head hit with a crack so hard I half expected my brains to spill out. But I guess that didn't happen, as ta-da! Every bone in my back felt like it had been pulverized by a troll with anger issues, and my neck cricked so painfully as I shifted an inch that I wondered if I'd ever hold my head up high again. The screams of a woman came to me through the fog of, the fog, and my own concussion. I assumed it was the driver freaking out, which you would, wouldn't you? Knowing how this went from past experience, I lay perfectly still and allowed the blood magic that gives me this immortality of a sorts to do what it did best. Bone knitted, or is it knotted, back together. Marrow formed, everything sliding back into place effortlessly, but with a pain so visceral, I blacked out several times in as many seconds. My month-old tattoos grew fat and poked at my clothes like they resented being hidden, jabbing sharp pins into tender flesh and lighting fresh nerves on fire. But as the hidden magic swirled through the ink like a wave, the healing process sped up exponentially, and in less than a minute I felt, if not groovy, then at least not utterly mangled. Being hit by a car, even something as ridiculous as a bright purple SUV, is astonishingly epic. I've been smacked and punched by all manner of supernatural baddies, mostly in the month since I foolishly agreed to stand in for my husband and be the first ever vampire enforcer for the Hidden Council. And only one thing has ever felt quite as crushing, and that was a body slam by a troll. Oh, there was the Sasquatch, but I was more concerned about the stink than the pain when that happened. The impact hit me at hip height and shattered my pelvis. But the real pain came from where my femurs were smashed. Bone split my leather trousers, and even as it disappeared and the wound healed, it made my legs feel like they were someone else's and just stuck on. Ignoring it all, mainly just pleased my spinal cord hadn't been severed, as I'm not sure I could ever come back from such an injury, I pushed with gravel-filled palms and sat up. The chemist, along with the driver, rushed over, her looking utterly terrified. Not because of the chemist, he was true hidden, so just looked like a rather unkempt guy in his 50s with a dodgy ponytail and a penchant for tie-dye, but because she'd assumed I'd be dead or severely mangled. "I'm okay, I think," I mumbled as I rubbed at my face, wishing I hadn't as the grit under my skin ripped gashes in my cheeks. I turned away as I felt flesh tighten, knowing it would freak her out even more.
"You are? Oh my God, I'm so sorry. This fog came out of nowhere and I couldn't see. I tried to brake, but it was too late, and then there you were. I'm so sorry."
She began to sob, stress overload seeking release.
"Chemist, help me up, would you?"
I asked, trying to ignore the pain as bone shifted about looking for the sweet spot. It's an indescribable feeling, the repairs going on under the surface, like someone's tugging all your bits from the inside, and not in a nice way.
"Sure, we should go,"
he said, glancing around warily. "Yeah, things to do, people to see," I said brightly, mainly for the benefit of the woman, as she needed to get the hell out of here and fast. He hauled me to my feet, and I brushed myself down ineffectively, acting like the incident was nothing.
"Should we exchange numbers, insurance or something?"
the driver asked, wiping away her tears and nervously rubbing a simple but obviously expensive pendant hanging from a slender silver chain.
"No, I'm fine, honest. It was just an accident, no harm done."
I smiled at her sweetly, and I could see she was already losing interest, her mind unable to keep our presence in focus.
"Well, if you insist..."
"I do."
"We do,"
agreed the chemist. We watched for a moment as she tried to process this, but us hidden aren't like regulars, and our magical nature meant she couldn't keep us in her thoughts, like we were the most unmemorable people on the planet. She'd never recall what we looked like or what had happened, only that she'd had a bit of a ding and hit someone, but that they were all right. If she saw me again, she wouldn't remember we'd already met.
"Let us walk you back to your car," said the chemist, looking harried, and gesturing to me with a worried hand as he put an arm around her shoulder and frog-marched her away.
"Oh, okay."
We hurried past the massive dent in her car. Thankfully, the fog and her own stress meant she didn't even glance at it. She got in, shook her head, and drove off, the accident already forgotten.
"Kate, we have to leave. This is serious, and we're in a lot of trouble."
"Trouble? What for?"
"Because of the potion. It's...
"What?" I snapped. "I'm a big girl. Just tell me."
"It's against the law. Not a hidden law as such, but certain groups won't be happy about this."
The chemist fumbled with his hands, wringing them together, and kept glancing around. "Who? What's going on here? Why were you making whatever this is, if it could get you into trouble?"
"I can't help it. It's what I do. I'm the chemist."
"Whatever. Just don't drag me into any nonsense. I've had a busy month, and I'm not in the mood for games."
"I think it's a bit late for that."
The chemist took a step back, and I turned to see what had had him so freaked. Three tall, shadowy figures emerged from the fog, their silhouettes promising all kinds of nastiness. What with the stretched-out bodies and the impossibly broad shoulders, the long limbs terminating in claw-like fingers that hung limp by their sides. "You dick," I muttered. The chemist squealed, then turned and ran away. So did I. Feeling sluggish. Usually I'm a fast runner. After all, I am a vampire. Maybe a relatively new one, having just a few years under my fangs. But nonetheless, I've got all the powers that come with the territory. And I'm a dab hand at what Faz calls the vampire shimmer shuffle. Here one minute, gone the next. Able to shoot through the night like a bullet, move at incredible speed without even getting out of breath. But the dinner weighed heavily on my stomach, and the accident meant my bones were weak, still repairing, and every time my foot hit the asphalt, it sent pain lancing through my thighs, up my spinal column, and into the back of my head where I'd smacked it. It all combined to make me feel like I was being attacked by a shortage of angry dwarves after I'd nicked their gold and made fun of their battle axes. Knowing I had to conserve energy for the repairs, I merely maintained pace with the chemist who, for a ghoul with a lopsided gait, a club foot and shoulders so hunched he kept having to lift his arms up as his knuckles scraped the floor, was surprisingly fast and nimble when sufficiently freaked out. Which he was. Every time I glanced at him, he looked more scared. Whoever, whatever, was after us, after him, was terrifying him. And he made his living telling bad jokes to pissed supernatural beings in an enclosed space late at night. After only 30 seconds, we'd escaped the menacing cloud of pink gas and were at the end of his street. He turned left and I followed, glancing behind as we took the bend. Back up the road were three of the strangest men I'd ever seen, and I've seen plenty of oddballs. I even live with one. They were clearly hidden, true hidden, not of this realm. Each was naked above the waist, wearing ill-fitting trousers that hung loose, the material tattered and coming only halfway down their shins. All three were little but skin and bone, stretched out as though on a torturer's rack. Their arms were bunched with misshapen muscles, hands ending in vicious nails as sharp as any shifter's. Their skin was pale, taking on the pink hue of the smoke, with broad rib cages covered in such thin skin the bones almost broke through. Their collarbones were impossibly wide, like a swimmer's and then some. Long necks held narrow heads with jutting chins, high foreheads, and each of them had a ponytail holding back perfectly straight hair that hung as limp as I assumed the chemist's libido was at this moment. But it was their faces that were the strangest, for there was no emotion there, and I couldn't imagine there ever could be. They were like waxworks, the skin shiny and thick so there were no wrinkles. Botox gone seriously wrong. Their mouths were set and closed, almost lipless, just a slash across smooth skin, snub noses little more than holes. Their eyes were tiny pinpricks of night, like they were all pupil, the way many humans look when in the throes of magic use. And they were just walking, intent on pursuit, but seemingly unconcerned with hurrying. I looked away, having taken it all in with a glance, no time having passed at all, and continued running as it seemed like the right thing to do under the circumstances.
Sorry about this, Kate. Guess I should have warned you about the glass.
You think? No more dinners for you. I think that hurt the chemist more than anything. He looked crestfallen. Fine, I said with a sigh. But next time, you're coming to ours. He smiled, then sped up. Charming. Resting up. The chemist didn't live in the best part of town, preferring somewhere that at least hinted at shadiness. So sitting by the canal full of old shopping trolleys, unwanted bicycles, and bizarrely a wooden replica of Michael Jackson standing proud right in the middle of the murky water, wasn't my idea of a pleasant evening. Amber light shone from a streetlight the other side of the narrow canal, part of the council's initiative to cut down on crime, when all it did was allow the bad guys to see better as they hit you over the head, then dumped you in the poisonous water. We sat on a graffiti-covered bench with several slats missing and caught our breath as we kicked at takeaway wrappers, beer cans and things that ought not to be left out in public. It was disgusting. How could such places still be so run down when most of the city gleamed with the ongoing regeneration projects? That's the modern world for you, I guess. The chemist breathed heavily, but I was fine. We'd been running for only 10 minutes, but he was beat. His skin was red, slick with sweat, and his chest heaved as he sucked in the fetid air. Air still 1,000 times better than in his own cramped hovel of a home. I watched, unable to help, as he crunched forward, putting his head between his legs, as he wheezed and coughed and batted at his chest with a fist to dislodge phlegm he spat away into the litter-strewn grass. Ghouls aren't built for running. They're built for hanging about in graveyards and digging up bodies once suitably decomposed. Their insides are all messed up, bits missing, organs in the wrong place, lungs small and everything wonky. Ghouls only survive here at all because they are true hidden, magical beings, and the chemist struggled to cope with his eternal banishment, even though he wouldn't leave for all the bodies in the graveyard. Didn't mean I wasn't furious with him. I had half a mind to throw him in the canal and just walk away, leave him to the rats and whoever the three dudes were coming after us. And I say us, as the way he was acting, I was caught up in this now. All I'd wanted was to do what I'd promised, cook him dinner, then be on my way. Now this? My month had already been incredibly hectic, working for Dancer doing enforcer jobs. Most went smoothly, little more than rounding up a few troublemakers. But it had taken a lot of my time, time I could have spent at home with my husband, working in our acreage, helping him recover. Faz had improved a lot the last month, finally getting out and about, but he was still months from returning to work, and to be honest, I was enjoying myself. Much as I tried to push down my vampire nature, this coldness that would overwhelm me if I let it. The virus craves wildness, danger, and violence, and I had been only too happy to provide what my body requested. I'd bashed heads, dragged off the bad guys, and gotten off on the madness. But I was aware of this, had reined in my wayward behaviour, stayed in control, and kept a watchful eye on my own actions so I retained my humanity. I was still Kate, just powerful and dangerous, and I was just about ready to blast the chemist into itty-bitty pieces for ruining our date. So, being the nice immortal vampire that I am, I smiled sweetly, turned to the idiot, grabbed his shirt, slammed him against the splintered bench and said, "What's all this about? You've got 1 second to start talking before I crush your head." "See, I can be nice when I try." The chemist hung his head, seemingly having given up the fight before it had begun, and sighed deeply, then coughed like it was his death rattle.
"I'm a bad ghoul. Terrible. Just terrible."
"Oh, goddammit!" I released him and sank back into the bench, my anger gone, replaced with sympathy for the disfigured man beside me. Guess it was a good sign. I still cared, wasn't violent and emotionless by default. "Okay, look, let's start at the beginning, but make it quick. Those guys, or whatever they are, won't take long to find us, and they look like they always get what they want."
"They do,"
whispered the chemist, looking more pitiful by the minute. "So tell me what's happening. What were you working on? What was in the beaker I touched?"
"Glass jar. It was a glass jar. Beakers are for mixing solutions together, not for potion making."
I pushed down the rising anger and said sweetly, "Okay, so what the fuck was in the glass jar?"
"A special potion, one I've been working on for many, many years. something nobody has ever done before in the history of hidden alchemy, and that includes ghouls. I would be the first to make such a thing. The power would be incredible. It would change everything, and that's the problem.
Okay, I said, so close to ripping his head off his shoulders, my tattoos were already squirming, fat and black as the eels wriggling through the canal silt. What exactly was this potion going to do that would take the supernatural world by storm and set those guys on you? On us?
It was to turn me into a man. A real man. A human man. No magic. No longer hidden. Just a man.
I squinted at him, thinking maybe he was winding me up. What, like Pinocchio? Make you a real boy?
Don't mock me, Kate. People have done that ever since I found myself trapped here. It's very hurtful. Can you imagine going through life looking like this? I disgust myself. I see people like you, so perfect, so pretty, so normal, and I can't stand it.
Normal? Huh, you don't know the half of it.
You know what I mean. All your bits and pieces in the right place. Everything symmetrical. Everything working. I'm a freak.
But you're a ghoul. You're meant to look like this. I never considered that he might have an issue with his looks. Hidden didn't think this way. As to them, their appearance was how it should be. Trolls didn't want to look like dwarves. Imps didn't want to look like wizards. And ghouls didn't want to look like, well, anything but ghouls. Hidden may be many things, but having body issues was a new one on me. That was the domain of insecure, body dysmorphic humans. Looking back on it now, I really wish I'd said this to him. It could have saved a lot of bother.
But I've been here a long time now, and I like it here. I have a past, Kate. All ghouls do. Not that I remember it. It doesn't work like that. And I must have done something truly terrible to become a ghoul. But I've had enough. I want to be normal, look nice, be able to shave and go have haircuts, go shopping for clothes, all of that. Even have dates.
He smiled and watched his hands tapping at his legs. And I guess I finally understood. Our date must have been excruciating for him. He knew I was doing it to repay a debt, not because I wanted to merely have dinner with him. That his appearance was off-putting, his way of life gross to us humans, or ex-humans, as I guess I am. And that must cut deep if you have the mindset to allow such things to trouble you. Okay, so the potion would make you human.
Maybe. I had another week to go, then it would have been ready. But you touched the glass. It woke early and it wasn't ready. As soon as it got the blood, it alerted the others and they've come to investigate. Oh, we're done for,
he wailed, clutching his head as he wept. Don't worry, I said, putting an arm around his shoulder. I'm sure we'll work something out. Sometimes I surprise myself with how good I am at lying. Divorce springs to mind. Okay, so who are the stretchy guys? I asked, removing my arm from the chemist's shoulder and trying not to wince too obviously at the layer of greasy grime now streaking my forearm. Maybe being human wouldn't be such a bad decision for him to make, certainly if it meant he'd shower more often. The chemist just groaned and sank further in on himself. So I slapped him, like I would a gnat, knowing what would happen. He flew off the bench sideways, body still crumpled, and didn't land until he hit the arch of a low tunnel. He crashed down onto the muddy pathway, several dirty red bricks nearly braining him. Bats flew out from the tunnel, disturbed by the commotion, which was kind of apt, or symbolic, or something. Not that I'm a bat, but vampire legend is so strong, many newly turned ask when they get the wings. I stormed over, splashing through the puddles, and yanked him to his feet. I was utterly calm. This wasn't me losing the plot, quite the opposite. Bizarrely, I wanted to help, even though he'd put me in a dangerous situation unnecessarily. If you can't help friends when they're down, even if it was you who put them on their ass, then who can you help? I held him up against the wall, feet inches above a puddle, then thought better of it and shifted so he dangled over the dark water. Getting right in his face, I said, "If you want, I can just throw you in now. If you think your life is so worthless that you're giving up, then please let me help you finish it. There are rats in here, and maybe they'll get a meal out of you. Or maybe you'll just sink and die and bloat up and rot away. You want that? Answer me."
"Okay, okay, I get the point. Gee, you could have just punched me on the arm gently."
The chemist smiled at me, and I couldn't help myself. I smiled back. Something about him made me think of him as a child, helpless in the world, unable to understand it, and in some ways he was an innocent. So obsessed with his alchemy and comedy that he failed to grasp the nature of the world he was in. Or, and this was a possibility, he was a self-centered bastard and just wanted to be left alone. You know, like most other people. Maybe he was already more human than he thought. I turned and dropped him down onto the path, then we walked back to the bench. Neither of us sat. "You good?"
"I'm good."
The chemist turned away from staring at the water and said,
"Thank you. You're right. I need to deal with this."
"No, we need to deal with this. We're friends. But no more running away and leaving me behind. Friends look out for each other, okay?"
"Okay."
"Now, can you please tell me who the hell the guys after us are?"
"They're the..."
My phone rang, startling us both. I grabbed my jacket off the bench and fished it out of a pocket, knowing that calls late in the evening should never be ignored. I put up a hand so the chemist would be quiet and said, "Hello?"
"Kate, it's me, Faz."
"Faz, where are you?"
Yeah, well, this is a little awkward."
"Awkward how?"
"Awkward as in, can you come and get me?"
"Get you? What's going on?"
I was getting worried about you, but I didn't want to interrupt, and I fancied a drive, so I headed over to the chemist's and thought I'd just check nothing had happened. You know what he's like, his potions and all."
"I know," I sighed.
"The place was a mess, but neither of you were there, so I knew you'd be okay. Then there was this weird pink cloud that kept following me down the road as I checked things out."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.